Welcome to session 11 of CSIT 103 Introduction to Computing Program. With this session, we will look at data encryption techniques. As we saw in the earlier session, we have one of the security mechanisms being data encryption. So we'll look at the techniques involved in this session. Session overview. Encryption is a method by which data, digital or otherwise, is converted into an encoded form that can only be decoded and read if the user possesses an appropriate encryption key. It represents one of several techniques that may be applied to protect data from unauthorized access. In this session, we consider the type of data that should be encrypted, when encryption should be done, and some available encryption techniques. We have the reading on the Sakai. Session outline, we look at introduction, data encryption methods, steganography, and digital signatures. Need to protect the data. Encryption. Encryption are encoding printers. The data or the characters we have, we normally produce. We term it, in this case, as printers. That is information to make it unreadable without special knowledge. And then the description process of, or is a process of decoding. The printers we have produced will be decoded into what we call a ciphertext. So transforming encrypted messages back to its readable original form is called decryption. Then crypto system is a system for encryption and decryption. So this actually comes under what we call cryptography in computing. So we have this network security model as shown here with a message from one end of the network to another end as a recipient. So sender and a recipient with the network infrastructure in between. But in encryption, we put a secret key here. And this secret key, what it does is it transforms the message from the sender and change the face of the message to another format that nobody can understand except the recipient who has the key to that encryption. So we call this symmetric encryption. That is the conventional encryption. Then we also have asymmetric encryption. Data encryption methods. Symmetric or conventional encryption. We need some key for both encryption and decryption. We need a key. The key should be same for the encryption and the decryption. So we have a plain text input here. We have whatever we are sending here, which is termed as plain text. And then after it goes through the encryption algorithm or the encryption key, which in this case we have an typical example of as AES, we have the details or the plain text changing to what we call a ciphertext. And it goes along sometimes with the key and sometimes without the key. So we get to another form here where the key is used to decrypt the details of the ciphertext and changes it to plaintext again for the recipient at this end to receive it. So at both end, we see we have both what? Plaintext. But it has to go through processes of transformations to get there. So we have plaintext, which always the original intelligible message, that's the input. Then we have encryption algorithm for performing various substitution and transformations. Then we have secret key. The secret key is also input to the encryption algorithm. Then we have ciphertext. This, the scrambled unintelligible message produced as output. Then we have decryption algorithm. Encryption algorithm run in reverse. In this case, output is original plain text. So as explained in the previous slides. Substitution ciphers. printf elements are replaced by other elements like numbers. In one way, we use substitution ciphers, where the printf, the elements, the alphabet or the characters involved in the printf are being replaced by other elements, can be numbers or symbols also. We have monoalphabetic ciphers, replacing the printf's bit patterns with ciphertext bit patterns. Example, we have Caesar cipher, monoalphabetic cipher, and the prefer cipher. These are all tests we are going to look at. Bajiro Caesar uses what we call shift of three. So when you have this printf in A, B, C, D, we have A being shifted three times to A be replaced by D, B replaced by E, C replaced by F, and so on, as we see here. And then Z is replaced by C. So this is how a shift of alphabet or cipher takes place. And this is what we call Caesar cipher. So when you have digital, we have A, B, C, D, E also being transformed or be represented as 0 to 12. And then we have N to Z also be represented as 13 to 25. So we have our alphabet system be represented as numbers also, 0 to 25. So in the encryption algorithm under a Caesar cipher, assuming we have an input data C, which goes through encryption three shifts of the printf. So three of P. So we have a value becoming P plus three, mode 26, because it's the normal alphabet scheme of 26 characters. So we have 26 here. Then we have C, which the second example is like this. So this is the typical formula for Caesar cipher, which is encryption K is the shift value, and then the P is the printf. So applying the shift value on the printf, in this example up here, we have three as the shift value. Then it equals to P, which is the printf, plus K, which is the shift value in mode 26. This is how we represent or change the face of our detailed information to be able to send across a network secured. Then, in the Caesar cipher, when it's sent at the receiving end or the recipient session, there must be what we call the decryption algorithm also working to change the data from the new format into the original printf format for anybody who can read it or who is supposed to read it, get it. So we have another formula that works at the other end with description algorithm of shift of three, in this case Caesar cipher, which has C, and this is C minus three mode 26. And then P is equals to D K C equals to C minus K mode 26. Caesar cipher characters, both encryption and decryption algorithm are known. That is, everybody knows the formula. 25 keys are used, 0 to 25. So it uses the normal alphabet of 26. Printf's language is known and all easily recognizable. So when you use a Caesar cipher, it is still not secured, because everybody who knows computing knows the Caesar cipher algorithm. So its advantages, it's easy to implement. Cipher is quite simple. But the disadvantage is that brute force cryptanalysis is easily performed. Everybody can work against it, decode it anyhow, at any time. It has an obvious pattern, which we understand, and then small key size. So it is not a very good cipher system to use now. Prefer cipher. With prefer cipher, multiple letter encryption cipher, it treats diagrams in the printf as single unit and translate these units into cipher test diagrams. It's based on 5x5 matrix of letters constructed using a keyword. So when we say prefer, it's primitive block cipher. The steps involved are: all letters are written in lowercase in pairs. Separate repeating printed letters that are in the same pair with a filter letter, such as X. If there are odd numbers of letters, choose an extra letter and add it to the end. The letters I and J count as one letter, as shown in the next slide. We have the prefer cipher below. So construct a 5x5 matrix by filling in the letters of the keyword minus duplicates from left to right and from top to bottom, like the alphabet system. And then fill in the remainder of the matrix with the remaining letters in alphabet order. So this is how you get it. So we have the structure as shown here. And we, what you do is you place two printed letters that fall in the same row of the matrix by the letter to the right, with the first element of the row, that is the table shown before, the previous table shown, circularly following the last. Example, if you have to an input value D, you can encrypt it. And by using prefer to encrypt, D will become E, and then because they are on the same row, the first alphabet, which is A, will follow E. So the value of DE in this case, in encrypted form, will be EA. Then, in replace two printed letters that fall in the same column by the letter beneath with the top element of the column, circularly following the last. So when you have QV, as in this diagram, two letters on the same column, when you have QV, you will definitely then finally have V, and then Y is the header of the column. So you have V and the Y as the encrypted value. Else, if it's not like that, following or the same row and column, then we replace each printed letter in a pair by the letter that lies in its own row and the column occupy the other printed letter. So example, BM becomes, if it's not the same row and the same column, then the third option we have is this: BM becomes DH. So we have BM as different lines. We have the value of the encryptor become what? D and what? H. Because B corresponding on the where M is what? D, and so on. So this is prefer cipher, uses this table. Its advantages: identification of individual diagrams is more difficult. Frequency analysis is much more difficult. Problems: it's relatively easy to break because it still leaves much of the structure of the printed language intact. So since most of the printed languages are the same on the table, it's easier to break through this as well. Transposition: moving pieces of printers around. There's another scheme we have, transposition, where the printer data or the pieces of the printers can be moved around, reshuffled, and so on. So performing permutation on the printer's letters. Types: we have ray fence as one algorithm, single columnar as another algorithm, and then double columnar as another. So transposition, we have different algorithms. One is ray fence. In ray fence, you write the printers as a sequence of diagonals and then read off as a sequence of rows. For example, if you are encrypting "meet me after the toga party," the value there you see is MEMA total group, and this is the kind of encrypted message you will get, as shown there. I show here. You see, this is what will represent meet me after the total. But this value has been, the same content has been reshuffled, has been permitted, has been changed, and has been mixed up. So this is how every character here is represented in this, but it is in another format altogether. So this is the value you can get. So the key is now the question, how this became this? It's what we call the encryption key. So as like the steps to do that in this single columnar one also, we get a keyword. The keyword and then number the letters according to their presence in the alphabet. We have like another as a keyword. If we have another, we will have to number the alphabet based on our alphabetical scheme. We have A coming first or A as single one. Then we have E, which is in alphabetically closer to A. So we have two, E being two, we have A being three, we have M being four, we have O being five, we have R being six, and we have T being seven. So another keyword, heaven. If we have a keyword heaven, we have heaven, H, A will be one, E be two, and so on. E, another E, since we have another E from left, so two and three. And then we have H being four, and so on. So these are based on the single columnar algorithm based on the keywords. So assuming we have to write the printers in rows under the numbered keyword. So giving a keyword another, encrypt I am the best. So this is how you do it. You have to have a keyword. You put the keyword down and then you have to encrypt I am the best. So this is how you do it. Your keyword is numbered already from 1 to 7. And so I am the best, as you write it under the keyword, you realize that I will be number one here. And so in your cipher test, you are writing I am the best, I will come first. Number two on the keyword is E, which comes the next three is, so we have two having E and X. So you write your I, and then which has, number one has I and E, number two has E and X, number three has H and X, number four has A and S, number five has M and T, number six has B and X, and then number seven has T and X. So this is what will represent our word or printers, I am the best. So the cipher test is what we see here. And this is what is representing this. This is the way we change face and we decode and encode for our smooth conversation on our networks. So similar to the singular, in the double columnar, similar to the single columnar transposition, process is repeated twice. Either use the same key twice or a different key for the second transposition. So example, using keywords another and heaven. Encrypt I am the best. So you do this, you get the same thing we got for the first time, the single columnar, and then we do for the next one, heaven. So this will also be subjected to another keyword heaven and also gives it another face altogether. So this is what we finally get if we are encrypting I am the best in second columnar, double columnar. This is what we get. So steganography. Steganography also is a Greek word, steganos, meaning covered or secret, and the Greek word graphy, meaning writing. So this is in short, secret writing. So the process of is the process of hiding a secret message within an ordinary message and extracting it as its destination. Hidden information can be printers, ciphertext, or images. Uses of steganography, like governments, disguising of corporate espionage. You know, when two governments are talking, they can use this kind of secret writing messages and hiding data in a normal message to send across and so on, especially in war fronts and so areas, and secret government message information or details. Business, watermarking images for copyright protection, tagging those to online images. Individuals, protecting data from possible sabotage, theft, or unauthorized viewing. So this is a business example, watermarking. So it's used, steganography can be used in governments, businesses, and individuals. Example, disguising of corporate espionage, businesses, watermarking images for copyright protection, tagging those to online images. Individuals also use protecting data from possible sabotage, theft, or unauthorized viewing. So steganography and security both seek to achieve similar goals, protecting data from unauthorized access and usage. Cryptography, which is what we look at in terms of encryption and so on, almost all the mechanism comes under cryptography. We have message is jumbled, yet the existence of data is not hidden. Steganography conceals the existence of the data. So these are the two differences. In security, we have cryptography, where message is jumbled, change face. The message is physically present. It's there. You can easily decrypt or decode it. But with steganography, the message is actually hidden. It conceals the existence of the data. So steganography ensures confidentiality. Hidden information is accessible to only authorized individuals. Both can be used together to produce better protection. So in the computing environment, especially in the networking, we make use of these two. We make use of both steganography and security, encrypted and cryptography, cryptography, so that we can secure better our infrastructure and resources. Then the next one we look at is digital signatures. Digital signature is an electronic signature used to authenticate the identity of the sender of a message. Like our normal signature, when you write a letter, you do not sign, it is not official, it becomes unacceptable. It's the same way here. When you have to send a message across, the other person or the other end wants to know if this message is actually coming from you. And that is why it demands what we call digital signature. So digital signature is an electronic signature used to authenticate the identity of the sender of a message and to ensure the original content of the message is not altered during transmission. Digital signatures are difficult to be reproduced by unauthorized users. Digital signatures come with timestamps, making repudiation difficult. Cryptographically based signature. Digital signatures enables a communicating party to, one, verify author or the sender, as well as date and time of signature. It also authenticates message contents. Be verified by third parties to resolve disputes. Digital signature must depend on the message to be signed. This makes the signature unique to each recipient. It helps prevent both forgery and denial. Must be relatively easy to recognize and verify. Digital signatures importance. Ensuring authentication. Recipient is able to confirm that the message originates from an authentic source. Integrity. Both communicating parties gain confidence that the message has not been altered during transmission. No repudiation. Attaching digital signatures makes later repudiation by the sender impossible or difficult. The implementation follows three algorithms. In a digital signature environment, we have key stroke signature generation algorithm. Then two, we have signing algorithm. Then we have verification algorithm. These are the three major algorithms involved. In the signing algorithm, we involve the use of sender's private key. So verification algorithm involves the use of the sender's public key. So actually, we are looking at two things differently here. We have two things involved. We have public key and we have private key. And as the name goes, private is private, personal, and public is open to all. So digital signatures of a message M is closely connected with the message M. Hence, different messages imply different signatures. This is opposed to a handwritten signature, which is the same for all message sent. So if I am Matilda and I'm sending a handwritten signature or a message, a letter, I sign as Matilda. And in all my correspondence, I sign as Matilda. If I'm using a digital signature, every message, I can design a different signatory for it. So it goes, every message will go with a digital signature, which is different from the previous message. As we see here, this is the Bob sending, transmitting something to Alice. So Bob's private key is utilized here, and then Bob alternative for M is sent. So here in the Alice area, Bob public key will be used because public, it's known at the recipient session, Bob public key, which Alice know, will be used to reactivate the message, mostly for signature verification. So this is the diagram for, or the architecture for the digital signature implementation. Digital signature algorithm examples are full domain hash, RSA PSS based on RSA, and then digital signature algorithm DSA, and then an elliptic curve, which is DSA part or ECDSA, then EI gamma signature scheme, so SCORN signature, secure hash algorithm SHA with RSA. So this is the different types of algorithms that can be implemented using in digital signatures. As you study your security course, you can put all this, you look at different types of these algorithms. So we have the reference as shown.